In this video, I'm going to present you our paper Context-Tailored Workload Model Generation for Continuous Representative Load Testing, published at the International Conference on Performance Engineering 2021. The authors of the paper are Henning Schulz, that's me, and Dusan Okanovic from the German IT specialist Novatec, André van Horn from University of Stuttgart, and Peter Thoma from Charles University, Prague. We are dealing with load testing, so what is this about? Zhang et Hassan define it as follows. A load test executes a workload against a system on a test. Let's imagine a campus management system here, and during the execution, measurement data like response times are collected. These data can then be used to detect functional and non-functional load-related problems. The campus management system is a session-based system, that is, each user has a session when interacting with the system. Therefore, the load test needs to model the following three major aspects. The behavior of a single user, namely the order and timing of requests they submit. The load intensity, that is, the number of users that interact with the system during the test. And parameterization, that includes, for instance, request parameters. To achieve reasonable load test results, it is crucial to model all three aspects appropriately. However, this modeling is non-trivial, as the following example shows. I will show you the number of concurrently active sessions of the student information system in Prague on the y-axis, over half a year in 2018 on the x-axis. In June, there is exams phase with a characteristic workload. Afterwards, there is vacation having a lower number of sessions. During course enrollment, the workload contains high spikes, followed by a yet different workload during the tuition phase. We can see a clear workload evolution which corresponds to external influences, which we use to call the context. Hence, a load test can never represent the whole workload, but rather the workload of a specific context, for instance, tuition. While the context you can see here seem to be repetitive, there can be other cases. An example happened at the beginning of last year, during the COVID-19 pandemic. Like most universities in Europe, Charles University in Prague decided to do online tuition. At that point, it was likely that the workload will increase, while it also was crucial that the system is in working order. A load test covering the overlapping effects of tuition and COVID-19 would have helped Charles University to provide high-quality online tuition. Therefore, we had the goal to develop and evaluate an integrated end-to-end framework for automatically generating load tests tailored to the context a user specifies, such as the COVID-19 online tuition scenario. Let's have a look at existing approaches that might have helped us reaching our goal. First of all, Ferrari has written already in the 1970s that the main objective in selecting a workload should always be representativeness. That is, a selected workload should represent the production workload. Hence, Menashe and others have introduced a load test generation methodology, which others, such as Vogel and others, have adopted. According to the methodology, session logs should be collected, clustered into a Markov chain-based workload model, and transformed to a load test that can be executed against the system on the test. The execution then delivers the measurement data to be analyzed, even though this is out of the scope of our work. In our previous work, we have automated the whole test generation process by automated parameterization. Also, we have introduced an approach to tailor the generated load test to specific microservices of a distributed application. However, there was no approach that further tailors the load test to a user-defined workload context. Therefore, we have extended the methodology in the presented paper. First, instead of only collecting a limited set of session logs, we now collect all of them in a continuous stream. These sessions are then clustered incrementally in batches. By storing the clustering results into a workload model repository, we obtain a knowledge base about all past workload. Precisely, we store a user behavior model per cluster and the load intensity, which varies over time. Furthermore, we enrich this information with context information such as the presence of tuition. Then we can perform the actual context tailoring, which consists of selecting appropriate data from the workload model repository, forecasting the data to the future, for instance, the COVID-19 scenario, and aggregating the forecast to a concise workload description. This description is represented by the workload model, and the remaining steps of the methodology remain unchanged. The context tailoring step is controlled by the user, who creates instances of the context tailoring description language we provide. That is, if they describe the COVID-19 tuition scenario, the methodology will then output a load test that simulates this scenario. A central step in this load test generation process is the forecasting of the workload. So we had to deal with the question, how can we predict a session-based workload? The input we continuously get are the user sessions. As explained, we store them in the workload model repository, enriched by their context. What we now would like to have is some kind of magic black box that takes as input the user sessions and the context tailoring description and outputs the future sessions of the COVID-19 workload. Luckily, there is this kind of magic black box, namely time series forecasting tools. Specifically, we are using the tools Prophet from Facebook and Telescope from the University of Würzburg. These tools are successfully used for performance engineering or capacity management tasks, so we decided to use them as well. However, they require time series as an input and also output time series, while we have user sessions on both sides. That's why we need the clustering. With the incremental session clustering, we group all the sessions into clusters of similar user behavior. For each cluster, we obtain an intensity curve, that is the number of concurrent user sessions over time. What you can see here actually is the real data from the student information system in Prague. The clustering also outputs one behavior model per cluster, which represents the average user behavior of that cluster. So we now can input the time series of number of concurrent sessions into the time series forecasting tools, and as an output, we get an intensity forecast. By merging the per cluster intensity forecast with the behavior models, we then obtain a representation of the future sessions of the workload we want to predict, for instance, the COVID-19 tuition workload. This is how our approach predicts a session-based workload. A major part of our evaluation was to assess the quality of these predictions. Precisely, we addressed the research question, how representative for future workload scenarios the forecasted workload models are. If you are interested in more evaluation of our approach, please have a look into our paper, Vary addressed further research questions and further aspects of the approach. In this video, we will stick to the question shown here. To find an answer to that question, we generated and executed multiple load tests. Basis for the generation was data from the Student Information System in Prague from that half year in 2018 I have talked about previously. We had all user sessions of that half year, which we input into our incremental session clustering. As output, we obtained the per cluster load intensities you can see here and user behavior models. We split the clustering outputs into two parts, one representing the past and one representing future workload. From the future workload, we selected specific scenarios, such as the sharpest spike during course enrollment. Based on the past workload, we tried to predict the same scenario using different configurations of our approach. We generated a load test that simulates the scenario, executed it, and compared its measurement data with the real data. In this way, we could assess the accuracy of our workload prediction. To measure the accuracy, we introduced a distance metric between the predicted and the reference workload. Detailed information about the metric is provided in the paper. Here, we show these distances of workloads predicted by different configurations of our approach. Perfect forecasting is a hypothetical case we use to assess the effect of the decomposition of user sessions into time series. We also used actual forecasting tools, namely Telescope and Prophet. Furthermore, we experimented with the clustering and context, meaning using them or not. We also calculated a baseline for the metric, representing the normal fluctuation of one and the same load test. We assessed a predicted workload to be optimal if it was below the baseline. These are our findings. Please note that this is a very condensed summary of our evaluation results. For further details, please again see our paper. First, we found that the clustering improves the prediction accuracy significantly by up to 70% depending on the forecasting tool and predicted scenario. Using the context improves the prediction further. However, most predictions were still above the baseline. When investigating the reason for that, we learned two lessons. The first lesson is that there can be situations where users change their timing behavior. The strongest effect we have seen was during the course enrollment. The course enrollment contained high spikes in the number of concurrently active users, also reflected in the number of requests received by the student information system. Here you can see the overall requests per minute during one such spike. The dashed blue line represents the predicted workload, which contains a notable spike. However, the reference workload has a way higher spike. Remarkably, the prediction of number of concurrently active sessions was very accurate in this case. Thus, we can only explain the difference with users that click the website more frequently. The load test generation methodology, however, does not account for such effects. The second lesson is that the forecasting tools sometimes fail to predict the appropriate curve shape. For instance, instead of a smooth increase, they predict a sharp jump. Here, our approach would benefit from improved forecasting tools that also can predict the curve shape. To conclude, in the presented paper, we introduced and evaluated an end-to-end framework that generates context-tailored load tests automatically, but also demands for future work to be addressed. On the one hand, this is the modeling of the changing user behavior, and on the other hand, this is the forecasting of the intensity curve shape. I would also like to welcome you to read our paper and to have a look at our evaluation artifacts, which are publicly available and have been evaluated to be functional and reusable.